Hi, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Alexis Campbell. I'm the press secretary for PennDOT. And thank you so much for joining us as we provide an update today on the Commonwealth's response to this winter storm event. Just a couple quick items before we get started. First, we'll have some comments from PennDOT Deputy Secretary Melissa Batula, and then from PEMA Director Randy Padfield. And then we'll have a Q&A period with the reporters who are on the call. Reporters, if you'll please stay on mute until your name is called, and I'll call on you in the order of your RSVP. So now let's get things started. I'm going to turn things over to Deputy Secretary Batula for her remarks.
Well, thank you. First, I'd like to thank everyone for the opportunity to be with you here today. I also want to thank our committed teams at both PennDOT and the Pennsylvania Turnpike Commission for the incredible work and dedication in these challenging conditions. We also want to thank the many drivers who have stayed off the roads both yesterday and today, for we're in the middle of one of the most impactful statewide storm events we've had in a long time. So we were and remain in active communication with other agencies, other states, and our industry partners. And a quick note on our driver and vehicle operations. So our photo license centers in many counties throughout the state are closed today, including our Riverfront Office Center in Harrisburg. You can check out dmv.pa.gov for more information on those centers. Regarding our roadways, I'd like to share some updates. Across most of the state, overnight, we saw isolated incidents that often occur during these types of storms. Additionally, we've implemented speed and vehicle restrictions on roadways in the most highly impacted areas of the state. These were done with a balance of precaution and flexibility to keep the goods moving. So we continue to evaluate current conditions and will adjust or add additional speed and vehicle restrictions if conditions warrant. You can check 511pa.com for the latest on these restrictions. So responding to the storm has truly been an all hands on deck type of situation. We have mobilized teams from both the Northwest and the Southwest regions of the state to assist with the hardest hit areas. We are expecting snowfall rates of 2 to 4 inches per hour in the Northeast. So this is going to be blizzard-like conditions in those areas. Visibility in these areas will be poor at best and will only worsen at nightfall. And while we were out in force to keep the roads safe and passable, it's truly critical that if you can avoid travel, do so. Now, when we look at storm operations, we always prioritize our high traffic routes so that vehicles that must travel do so as safely as possible. And we also prioritize routes leading to our healthcare facilities. So we move staff both before and during the storm to address the specific regional needs. And again, the 511pa.com is a continued resource for you for the latest travel information. So even once the storm moves out of the state, our mission will continue. As with every storm, we will continue to treat our roadways throughout the storm until roads are clear. As cleanup continues, we ask the public to avoid non-essential traffic so our crews can get the roads clear, because it will take time to clear all lanes and the shoulders. Now, just keep in mind, even if a road appears clear, please use caution as our slow moving plow trucks are out in full force. So in addition to the latest traffic conditions, our 511 PA service also shows the location of 1,000 traffic cameras that you can view and where our vehicles are and when the state roads were last plowed. So again, we ask you to be our continued partners in keeping our roadways safe. That means if you must drive, please do so based on the conditions, slowing down, and giving our plows and every other vehicle plenty of space. So please think of safety first, today and every day. Thank you. And next will be Director Randy Padfield of the Pennsylvania Emergency Management Agency.
Thank you, Deputy Secretary Batula. Good afternoon, everyone. As we do with a lot of weather systems, we've been monitoring this storm system since before it even entered the U.S. while it was still off the West Coast. We do this to anticipate impacts and timing so that we can be better prepared to respond to any situations that would arise during the storm. As we have seen in the past, many systems this time of year can be complex, which requires us to be nimble to adjust plans and tactics based on the immediate impacts, since they can quickly change. No two systems are exactly similar or alike, so being able to quickly identify changes and respond accordingly is really key to protecting citizens. Yesterday, we upstaffed our Commonwealth Response Coordination Center, which has been activated continuously for the COVID-19 response since last March, in anticipation of the impacts of the storm. Even before we upstaffed and officially added additional staffing for the storm, there was a series of coordination calls in the days leading up to it so we could monitor the weather forecast and adjust to any changes as needed. The Commonwealth Response Coordination Center is staffed either in person or virtually by personnel from Pennsylvania Emergency Management Agency, Pennsylvania Department of Transportation, Pennsylvania State Police, the Turnpike Commission, and National Guard. Other state agencies, such as the Pennsylvania Public Utility Commission, American Red Cross, Department of Human Services, and Department of Health, stand at the ready to assist depending on the impacts. The activation includes our Business Emergency Operations Center, which is critical in distributing information to private sector partners that may be impacted by highway travel restrictions that are implemented throughout the storm due to deteriorating road conditions. Because storm impacts are dynamic and conditions change rapidly, it requires regular coordination and continual communication among state agencies, neighboring states, and our county partners to address any impacts, adjust travel restrictions as conditions change, and respond to any incidents that occur. We do this all in an effort to balance the safety of the citizens while trying to minimize disruptions to the distribution networks, as the Deputy Secretary discussed. During this storm, we're specifically concerned about ensuring shipments of COVID-19 vaccine can make it safely to their final destinations. While these shipments are scheduled by the federal government using commercial shippers, we have the ability to monitor these shipments and assist in troubleshooting any issues to ensure that they are safely delivered to their final destinations. We've seen great success when implementing this strategy in the past relative to limited time travel restrictions, as it significantly reduces significant incidents that result in major roadways being closed for extended periods of time, which sometimes jeopardizes the motoring public's safety. Thus far, we have seen some impacts from the accidents and incidents overnight. However, they've resulted in highway closures that have been in limited impact and have not stranded anyone outside in the inclement weather for extended periods of time. Obviously, you know, we really like to thank everybody that has stayed off the road up to this point, because it really, with the complex nature of this storm, the impacts could have been much greater. Our staff is also monitoring for other impacts, such as power outages, heating failures, and other types of situations that we see this time of year that are really exacerbated by the cold weather or that result in problems with extended response times due to inclement weather and road conditions. As this current storm continues to evolve, we want everyone to know that we are prepared to respond to any situation that may arise. We also ask that everyone avoid travel if at all possible, especially during times when snowfall rates increase significantly. As the Deputy Secretary indicated, there are some areas of the state where we anticipate snowfall rates of between 2 and 4 inches an hour, which is very difficult to be able to maintain roadway conditions during, and is very difficult to see. So we really want the public to stay off the roadways during those times. If you must travel, we ask that everyone be aware of road conditions, such as going to 511 PA, to assess the road conditions along your travel route, and drive with due regard to the road conditions. Plan accordingly and be prepared in case conditions change rapidly, to include potentially becoming stranded if roadways become impassable. Thank you for everything that you've done up to this point. And now I'd like to turn the press conference back over to Alexis, who will open it up for questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Padfield. So first up, we have Victoria Lucas from Fox 43.
Yes, hello. Yes, hi. My question is for the deputy, Ms. Melissa Batula. I just wanted to know if you guys were teaming up with officials, any capacity police, to, you know, help those in need in this time if accidents may occur on the roads.
Yes, we are actually in constant communication with both the Pennsylvania State Police and PEMA. And if we do have stranded motorists, we have the ability to reach out and make sure they get what they need to stay safe during that event. As Director Padfield said, fortunately so far with the storm, with people staying off the roads, we haven't seen extended period of times that have left to that. But again, we are in constant communication with our Pennsylvania State Police and work together as those incidents do occur.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next, we have Ryan Eldridge from CBS 21. Ryan, you can go ahead and unmute and ask a question if you've got one.
Yeah, hi, everybody. Thanks for having us. My question is specifically, and I know Director Padfield, you had just addressed that, but I don't think it's so much all about the vaccine. It's also about making sure that medical service personnel, essential workers, and then any essential treatments or drugs can get to where they need to go to not only help COVID-19 patients, but also Pennsylvanians in need, and so that those workers can get to Pennsylvanians in need and get to the hospital system. Can you talk about what those efforts look like and maybe some of the precautions you've taken to make sure that essential workers are taken care of throughout this storm?
Sure, Ryan. That's a very good question. So, you know, it is a multi-layered approach. So many of the healthcare institutions have their emergency operations plans. They have ways to be able to get their essential personnel in, or they hold over their essential personnel during times of inclement weather. Obviously, if there's needs for transportation of those folks, they can reach out to our county partners, our emergency management coordinators that are in the counties. They also have resources that they can bring to bear. And if it exceeds the county's capabilities, then obviously they can send a resource request to us, and we have the ability to be able to task either different state agencies with the ability to be able to go out and move people if we need to. Usually this is handled at a much lower level, but we have had extenuating circumstances in the past where we've had to deploy National Guard to be able to go out and handle this. When it comes to not just the COVID-19 vaccine, but other supplies, there are ways, obviously, and the Deputy Secretary discussed this, our personnel work together in the Commonwealth Response Coordination Center. So if we have any specific need to be able to get a commodity to a certain institution, we have the ability to be able to work with Pennsylvania State Police, our county partners from emergency management, the Turnpike Commission, if it's coming across the Turnpike, as well as PennDOT, to be able to make sure that we have the ability to be able to get that valuable commodity to wherever it needs to get to in a timely fashion. We really take responsibility for this and make sure that we have the folks that are coordinating and communicating on a regular basis. We know that we've had situations before where, you know, people have been trapped in trapped queues out there in the roadway because of major incidents that have occurred. And we've been able to work as a group of agencies to be able to either get something that's, you know, a commodity that's in that trapped queue out of there to be able to get it on the road or to be able to reroute it. And we've done very similar situations in the past where we have folks that have specialized medical needs, such as folks that are on transplant lists and those types of things that, you know, worst case scenario, if something would become available to them during an inclement weather event, we have the ability to be able to work with all of our partners to be able to get them to where they need to be able to receive that transplant. So it's really a seamless system, but it requires constant communication and constant monitoring of all the conditions.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next up is Dickie Nassar from KDKA, who I don't believe is here. Sorry about that. Next, after that, will be Miles Bryan from WHYY. Oops, excuse me. Miles, you can go ahead and unmute.
Yes, hello. Can you hear me?
We can.
Thanks. Thanks for being here. I don't know if I have any specific questions other than can you folks, especially with PennDOT, speak to the situations around Philly in terms of highway passability advice? You know, for my audience, I think they'd be especially curious to know about what the roads are like in Southeast PA and what you're seeing and hearing.
Right now, the roads in Philadelphia aren't terribly bad, but we are concerned about the high winds that we're seeing in Philadelphia right now with, I'm hearing of 10 to 15 miles per hour sustained and 30 miles per hour gusts, which really raise a concern on the interstate system. Should we have empty tractor trailers that don't have any load for the, you know, the ability really of being blown over? So at this time, we do have tier one restrictions. So that prohibits vehicles that are empty or commercial vehicles that are empty from running on those. So those are the restrictions we currently have place in the interstates around Philadelphia. But we do not have any more severe restrictions on that because the conditions are relatively good overall on the interstate systems.
Thank you. Next, we'll go to Thomas Fitzgerald from the Philadelphia Inquirer. Thomas, you can go ahead and unmute and ask your question. Then we will go to Sam Dunklow from WITF. Go ahead and unmute, Sam.
Good afternoon. This is for either Director Padfield or Deputy Secretary Batula. You mentioned at the beginning of the presser that this is more or less a historic snow event. At least it's as much snow as we've seen in the last couple of years. Can you give us any historical precedent in terms of what you've seen and how you're responding to it?
I can start, and then Director Padfield, if you'd like to add anything, you certainly can. I'd say one of the biggest challenges we're seeing with this storm is just the sheer duration of it. So it started about 10 o'clock yesterday morning or so. Our crews have been working nonstop, and then, of course, moving into the day where we're seeing the nor'eastern type of snowfalls, with we're talking about, as Director Padfield said, and I said earlier, 2 to 4 inches per hour. In those kind of conditions, it's nearly impossible to keep up fully with that snowfall because of the rate it's falling. So that's why we've been really messaging about staying off those roads. Just think of it this way, you know, our plow truck drivers are generally working 12-hour shifts. So they're on 12 hours, they're off 12 hours, and then they're back. So when we see these extended storms stretching into tomorrow, it really stretches our resources. And we've got the dump trucks that are running, you know, that full time too. Because again, you know, somebody gets off of that shift, they go off, the truck keeps running. So it's a very lengthy storm to be having, especially a statewide impact.
And from our perspective, you know, there are historic snowfall records, and we track those, and that really plays into whether we have, you know, a case to be able to apply for a federal disaster declaration to be able to help with snow removal costs and those types of things. You know, Pennsylvania has seen some pretty historic snow events over the years. I'm not sure whether this will get to that level. It may in some of the impacted areas and some of the counties. And that's why it's really key working with the National Weather Service and, you know, the folks that actually monitor snowfall amounts out there in the counties to be able to have, you know, a good approach to that so we can kind of reconstruct this after the fact to see whether it actually does meet the historic snowfall requirement for us to be able to apply for federal disaster declaration assistance. However, you know, I will say that, you know, we've seen a lot of these storms, and I think the key really is understanding that what we've seen over the years is the fact that these heavy precipitation events, these banding events that occur where we get these high snowfall rates may not be something we've seen in the past. And some of this is predicated on changes of the weather patterns that we've seen, very similar to a lot of the flash flooding that we've seen. We see intense precipitation events. And I think what's key from that perspective is, you know, we try to anticipate those. We try to work with the Weather Service and our state meteorologists to anticipate where that is going to set up and then make sure that we're poised to be able to respond accordingly, because that can very quickly overcome local resources and create challenges if we have a lot of folks that are out on the roadway at that point in time trying to get from, you know, wherever they're traveling from to a specific destination. So the key is really identifying those types of situations, monitoring for the potential, and being able to respond accordingly to be able to get the proper information out to folks. Maybe they should, you know, consider getting off the roadway, seeking shelter temporarily until conditions improve, those types of things, to be able to, you know, really keep the public safety in mind.
Thank you both. Next, we will go to Hayden Mittman from Lehigh Valley Public Media. Hayden, you can go ahead and unmute and ask your question.
Hi, thank you so much for having me on. I wanted to ask, we're still in the middle of a coronavirus pandemic. Could that hamper any efforts to address this snowstorm? Any drivers that might not be able to show up for work because of the coronavirus? Or is there any issues that might arise simply because it's a difficult year for everyone?
Yes, absolutely. I'd say staffing is always a concern, especially when you're looking at a statewide event. And, you know, we're not immune to the coronavirus. We do have some employees that are out ill with the virus. That being said, again, we're making the best use of those resources. As I said, we've shifted those crews from the Northwest and the Southwest into those hardest hit areas to be as nimble as we possibly can to address this. But that being said, we are fully engaged. So we have all our trucks fully all our routes covered, and we are again keeping everything moving at this point. So again, yes, of course, it's going to have some impacts, but we've responded accordingly.
Thank you. Next up is Ford Turner from The Morning Call. Go ahead, Ford. You can unmute and ask your question.
Hi, Deputy Secretary Petula. Can you say anything about if you have a concentration of equipment or manpower in the northeastern part of the state, given the the radar shows these heavy bands there, and you talked about those heavy snowfall rates?
Yeah, that's been some of the areas that we've shifted the crews up to. We've added crews in Luzerne County to help battle that storm. So that frees up those resources that would normally be, I'd say, on the interstate there to move that up to have other covers, other areas. So yes, we have staffed up. As far as are we seeing COVID sickness losses in that area, if that was the question, I'd say no, that's not I'm sure there's a few, but it's not anything that's extreme in that area. But again, we have shifted resources up there to help with, because exactly as you said, that's a very hard hit area and we're anticipating that. But thank you for the question.
Thanks, Ford. Next is Catherine Rubright from the Pocono Record, and this is going to be our last question. Go ahead, Catherine, you can go ahead.
Thanks. This is for Deputy Secretary Batula. I know this is, of course, a drawn-out situation, and we're definitely not done with it yet, but can you just kind of talk about what you look at as far as lifting restrictions and kind of what you're looking for to know that it's safe to go ahead and do that?
It'll be two things mostly. It'll be what's actually happening right now. So are we still seeing those dangerous snowfall amounts coming in where it's restricting visibility? And then the second component of that is what's the condition of the road? So, are we get to a point where we've got it treated where it's back to, I'll say, black pavement and we got full traction? As far as the full vehicle bans, again, the biggest thing is where are we at with the storm and do we have the visibility so it's actually safe for those vehicles to return? So I'd say, in a nutshell, it's really coming down to, is it safe for those vehicles to return at that point?
Thanks so much, everybody. We appreciate you joining us today. That brings us to the end of our media briefing. And please stay safe and healthy. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.